I'm Dr. Fakir Avari and this is Non-inferiority Clinical Trials. Pause this video and take a moment to review these definitions. Now, let's take a look at the quality of evidence hierarchy. At the bottom of the pyramid, you can see that we have the lowest quality of evidence. And these are data from animal data, simulation study, and expert opinion. Sometimes in the absence of higher quality evidence, these studies can actually be useful. Now, higher in the pyramid, we have case reports and case series, and these are descriptive studies. Slightly higher quality than this, we have case control studies and cohort studies, which are observational studies. And then we have very high quality evidence from control trials. So we have non-randomized control trials and randomized control trials, and these are extremely important because these are experimental studies, and I'll mention why this is very important. And of course, at the top of the pyramid, we have systematic reviews and meta-analysis, which we will discuss on a later day. The first learning objective is distinguish between superiority and non-inferiority clinical trials. Let's take a look at randomized clinical trials. There are three general designs of RCTs. The first one is a superiority trial. The point of superiority trial is to show the treatment in intervention group is more effective or superior compared to control group. This design is used for establishing new standard of care, meaning that in the absence of standard of care, it's ethical to give a control group a placebo. In situations where we have good standard of care, it might be unethical to give the intervention group a treatment that is not standard of care. The second design is non-inferiority trials. This design is to show that the treatment is not worse compared to control group. It is used for establishing alternative care. In other words, it's used when we have a drug that's not necessarily superior to the standard of care, but it might be another alternative. So we will use a non-inferiority design for that. And the last design is equivalence, which is used to show the treatment is not more effective and is not worse compared to control group. This design is used for establishing generic drugs that are equivalent to their brand formulation. Now, for superiority studies, the primary objective is to determine the magnitude of increased benefit of the experimental intervention over standard therapy for effectiveness outcomes. In non-inferiority studies, the researchers are unconcerned if the experimental is better as long as it is not much worse. And I'll mention what this means, not much worse. Now, let's take a look at non-inferiority margin, which is known as delta. So how much worse or how much less effective really depends on the importance of the effectiveness outcome and the magnitude of the reduction in harm or burden achieved by the new treatment. So the threshold for how much worse is actually known as non-inferiority threshold or non-inferiority margin, and it's denoted as delta. Now keep in mind that there is no universally accepted method for defining an appropriate threshold. However, the FDA in the US actually has produced a guidance for industry which actually gives guidance about choosing a non-inferiority margin. We distinguish between superiority and non-inferiority clinical trials. Now, let's interpret clinical and surrogate endpoints used in non-inferiority clinical trials. Now, let's take a look at the forest plot. So here, I'm showing you 8 different examples. So in a forest plot, on the x-axis, we're looking at the actual outcome. So this is a generic version, so you can either, you know, plot difference, absolute difference, or you can plot a relative risk. But more importantly, on a forest plot, the circle actually means it shows you the point estimate of the actual study, and then the H shows you the confidence, the 95% confidence interval. So it shows you like the lower bound of the confidence interval and the higher bound of the confidence interval. And the circle is actually what they found, is the point estimate of what they found in that study. Now, in this orange line, it's actually showing you the point of no difference. So if you're looking at the difference, zero would mean no difference. And if it's relative risk, one would mean no difference. And of course, if you're less than difference less than zero or relative risk of less than one, it would be in favor of intervention treatment. And on the other side, you will be in favor of standard treatment or the control group. So far, we have only discussed superiority. So that would mean either intervention is superior to your control group, or the control is superior to intervention, which would mean that the intervention is inferior to the control group, or there would be no difference. So when you look at example A, you can see that here's the point estimate and here's the confidence interval, and the confidence interval did not cross the line of no difference. And we call that the superiority. So we will say that your intervention is superior to control group. Now, when it comes to non-inferiority studies, it's okay to cross the line of no difference because we're not really trying to show that the intervention is superior to the control group. But what we're really interested is to show that it's not too much worse. And too much worse is defined by the non-inferiority margin. So NI margin or non-inferiority margin or delta. So instead of line of no difference, now we're looking at the margin. So as long as the confidence interval doesn't cross the delta, then we can claim non-inferiority. So in example B, it definitely crossed the line of no difference for superiority, so we cannot claim that intervention is superior to control. But because it didn't cross the delta, now we can claim that the intervention is non-inferior to the control group. The same is true with choice with example C. So it doesn't matter if the point estimate is to the left or to the right of the line of no difference for superiority. What matters is that the confidence interval itself must not touch or cross the delta. So both B and C are considered non-inferior, and both of them failed superiority. Now, for the purpose of this course, we're gonna call any of these that actually crossed delta, we're gonna say it did not show non-inferiority. So don't worry about calling it inconclusive or inferior. What's important is that, because I don't want you to be confused by how to define inferiority versus inconclusivity, we're just gonna call it either it showed non-inferior like B and C, or it could not show non-inferior. So choice D, we're gonna say it failed to show non-inferiority, or it was not non-inferior. So choice E, example E, is not non-inferior because the confidence interval crossed delta. The same with D, it crossed delta. The same with G, it crossed delta. So it is not non-inferior. Now, choice F, it didn't cross non-inferiority line, so we can actually say it was non-inferior. The reason they're calling it self-want inferior because the entire thing is to the right of the line of no difference. So again, for this class, don't worry about that. Just focus on what's non-inferior, what's superior, and what's not non-inferior. So D, E, G, and H are not non-inferior because they are on the right or cross the delta. Sometimes in non-inferiority studies, they will also check for superiority. So although initially they weren't really trying to show superiority, they were looking for non-inferiority. Once they achieve non-inferiority, they also check for superiority to see if they actually met superiority too. So you can see in this first example, this was a non-inferiority study. So they definitely met non-inferiority because, as you can see here, the confidence interval did not cross the margin. So the margin is all the way to the right at 1.2. So not only did it not cross the delta, but also it did not cross the line of no difference. So that's why in this first example, they're claiming both non-inferiority and superiority. Now in the second example, they failed to show superiority because it crossed the line of no difference, but it was able to show non-inferiority because it didn't cross the margin. In the third one, it again achieved non-inferiority because it didn't cross the margin, but it also inferiority, because the entire thing is on the right side of the line of no difference, which again, as I mentioned for this class, don't worry about inferiority, just focus on non-inferiority. And also don't worry about inconclusive. This slide summarizes what I just described. As you know by now, superiority trials must always use a two-sided or two-tailed significance level, or a two-sided alpha. When investigators perform a single randomized controlled trial, the result is a single point estimate, which means that if they were to repeat the study, they may get a different result. That's why it's extremely important to look at the 95% confidence interval. In other words, when the results are of a randomized control study is found, that's just a single point estimate. So the question is, if we do this study again, what's the likelihood that we will get something similar? And that's where we get the 95% confidence interval. So, you know, the results of the study is a point estimate. And if we were to repeat the study, there's a 95% chance true mean will be between that confidence interval. Now, this is important because there are 5% of the time where we may actually get outliers outside of the 95% confidence interval. And that's why we have this equation. If you have a 95% confidence interval, then the alpha should be large enough to cover the remainder that the confidence interval doesn't cover. So typically we use a 95% confidence interval, so which means that there are 5% left that's not covered by the confidence interval. So that's why we typically use a two-sided alpha of 5%. Meaning that it covers the 2.5% on the right side and the 2.5% on the left side. And that's why we mean by the two-sided. Now, when it comes to non-inferiority trials, we really only care about one side of the confidence interval, because we're not necessarily trying to show superior. We're just trying to show that it's not worse than the intervention is not worse than the control. So the reason we use a two-sided alpha in superiority is because depending on what side we're going to, it can either be superior or it could be inferior to the other group. Whereas in non-inferiority, we're only looking at one side because we're just trying to show non-inferiority. And that's why it's okay to use a one-sided alpha. So, which, means that now we need to alter that equation. So if we were to use a one-sided alpha, it's okay to use an alpha of 2.5% with the 95% confidence interval, because we're only interested in one side of the distribution. In other words, if we're using an alpha of 2.5 in a non-inferiority trial, we multiply by 2. So 2.5 times 2 is 5, and now you get the complete 100%. Now let's look at Hokusai VTE trial, which was a non-inferiority. The primary endpoint was the first recurrent VTE or VTE-related death, and they're trying to show that edoxaban is non-inferior to warfarin. And they said the non-inferiority margin of 1.5. So what they found was the hazard ratio of 0.89. So 0.89 is the point estimate in this study, and if they were to repeat the study again, the true mean of the hazard ratio would be something between 0.7 to 1.13. And of course, it crossed the line of unity, so it could not show superiority, which is okay because this is a non-inferiority. They weren't really trying to show that edoxaban is superior to warfarin. Instead, they're trying to show that edoxaban is non-inferior to warfarin. And because the delta is 1.5, and the confidence interval doesn't include the delta, now you can claim non-inferiority. Now, it's extremely important to keep track of your p-values. This p-value that's significant here, this is the p-value reported for non-inferiority. In fact, in the same paper, they also tell you the p-value for superiority, and it was greater than 0.05. So if you see the p-value, you have to first make sure that whether it's the p-value for superiority or for non-inferiority, because the p-value for superiority, it should be greater than 0.05 in this case because it failed superiority. However, the p-value for non-inferiority should be significant as it did not cross the delta. Now, the next example, the primary endpoint was prevention of all stroke, ischemic or hemorrhagic, and systemic embolic event. So they're trying to see if this drug is non-inferior to warfarin. And they're looking at an absolute difference. So they found the difference of negative 0.7, which is the point estimate in the study. And they said if you do this again, you get something between negative 1.4 and 0.1. This was a non-inferiority study, and they set the non-inferiority margin at 2. Now, this crossed the line of unity, which is 0, so it failed to show superiority. However, it did not cross delta. So although it failed superiority, it was actually able to show non-inferiority. So this drug is non-inferior to warfarin. Now, look at the p-value. So this is why you need to be careful with the p-value. If you had just looked at the p-value and said this is not statistically significant, you would have been wrong, because this p-value that they reported in the paper is actually for superiority. So it's a true p-value because failed superiority, so the p-value is consistent with it. However, they didn't show you the p-value for non-inferiority. And we don't really need the p-value. We can just look at the confidence interval and say that it didn't cross the delta, so therefore this drug is non-inferior to warfarin. The last example is the comparison of prasugrel to clopidogrel. The primary endpoint, composite outcome of ischemic stroke, MI, or other vascular death. And they showed that the risk ratio was 1.05, so this is the point estimate in this study. And if you do it again, you get something between 0.76 to 1.44. So it definitely crossed the line of unity, so it felt superiority, but this is a non-inferiority study. And they set the margin at 1.35. So it actually crossed 1.35. So not only did it fail superiority, but it also failed non-inferiority. So you can conclude that prasugrel is not non-inferior to clopidogrel for this primary endpoint of composite outcome of ischemic stroke, MI, and other vascular death. We distinguish between superiority and non-inferiority clinical trials and interpreted clinical and surrogate endpoints in non-inferiority trials. Now, given a non-inferiority clinical trial, let's evaluate its internal validity.
So when it comes to internal validity, basically you will ask the same questions as you would when you evaluate the internal validity of superiority study. So the first 9 questions are actually the same 9 questions that you would ask and evaluate for a superiority studies. Now, something that's specific to non-inferiority studies is, were patients analyzed in the groups to which they were randomized. So when it comes to non-inferiority studies, it's actually extremely important to have both per-protocol analysis and intention-to-treat analysis. As I had mentioned previously that, generally in superiority studies, you really want to have an intention-to-treat analysis. And there are some exceptions, like, for example, if you were looking for toxicity of a drug, you really want to have per-protocol analysis. However, when it comes to non-inferiority studies, if you get both per-protocol and intention to treat analysis and both are in agreement, they actually make a stronger case for non-inferiority. So, not to say that, if they only included one, you cannot claim non-inferiority, but when you do journal clubs on non-inferiority, you should look for both per protocol and intention to treat. And then the other question that you should ask is, did the investigators guard against an unwarranted conclusion for non-inferiority? So because we're looking, at how much worse your intervention can do, you really want your control group to receive the best treatment. So if the control group receives suboptimal treatment, then it becomes easier to achieve non-inferiority. So, suboptimal, it could be, whether the patients are not adherent, or, based on enrollment, you can have patients that are less likely to have the outcomes. So that's really important to assess in non-inferiority studies. The other thing that's important is to actually compare the event rates in the control group compared to studies that have been done in the past. So if the number of events is actually less in the new study, it's a lot easier to achieve non-inferiority, and you should question whether this is due to differences in patient populations or, there was something specific about the study leading to less events in the control group, which makes the intervention group be easier to show non-inferiority to the control group.
We distinguish between non-inferiority and superiority clinical trials and interpreted clinical and surrogate endpoints used in NI trials. We also looked at internal validity of non-inferiority trials. Now, given a non-inferiority clinical trial, let's evaluate its external validity.
So, external validity will basically looking at, generalizability of the study. So, we still ask the same questions as we would ask when we evaluate a superiority study. So you want to make sure these patients are similar to our patients. We want to make sure that patient important outcomes were included in study. And something that's important about non-inferiority is that because, occasionally some, your intervention could be a little worse than the standard treatment, but not too much worse. In other words, not more than the non-inferiority margin. This might be something to discuss to the patient because, the patient really needs to know the actual numbers. Like if we say for example, if you're talking about heart attacks, you can say so this drug will cause a little more heart attack, but not too much more. The patient may not be comfortable, receiving a drug that's non-inferior to the standard treatment. So shared decision making is something that's important in modern medicine. And what shared decision making means is that, the patient should be included in the decision making. In other words, the physicians, the pharmacists, and also the patients should be included in the discussion when a treatment is selected for the patient, so that they know all the risks and benefits, and they can have a saying. Especially when it comes to patient preferences, that would be some important factors when choosing a treatment that's non-inferior to a standard of care. This concludes this presentation on non-inferiority trials.